It's been said that fire is the greatest serial killer of all time. I'm Adrian Butler. This film marks the end of a long and hard journey for all of us who are part of the international crusade against fire deaths. It all started back in January 2000 with the award-winning Canadian documentary Silent Alarms. Silent Alarms exposed a well-kept secret that the type of smoke alarms most of us rely on are nowhere near as safe or as reliable as we've been led to believe. However, Silent Alarms named names and was silenced due to litigation. But this story has to be told, so we decided to make our own documentary, one that couldn't be silenced.
The majority of smoke detectors sold today do not detect the type of fire most likely to kill you. Tom Clark, investigative journalist, Silent Alarms. What you are about to see could save your life. It could save the lives of your family. This film will educate you on the deadly reality of fire in the... We will expose the dangerous belief that one smoke alarms will provide warning when fire strikes. You will learn that the type of smoke detectors you use could make the difference between or death.
A common sight now down the supermarket, someone's doing their shopping, they go down the hardware section, grab a couple of smoke alarms off the shelf, chuck them in the basket, get home and throw them up on the ceiling, and they think their home's protected. What we're going to do in this film is educate you about the real problem of fire in the home. And once you've got that level of understanding, then we're going to tell you about the solution that we think is a far better solution to fully protect your family from fire.
I'm Ian Johnston, and for 10 years I presented television's Crime Watch. The story that I have for you now is about a family tragically torn apart by fire.
On January the 18th, 1993, in Davenport, Iowa, 3-year-old Bradley and 18-month-old Travis Mercer were sleeping upstairs while their parents, Nathan and Bradley, were watching TV downstairs. Nathan had installed an alarm on the ceiling at the top of the stairs to the second floor bedrooms of their duplex. The baby monitor short-circuited in the boy's bedroom and started molded for at least 15 minutes. Nurses were alerted not by their alarm, but by the smell of smoke. While Jennifer rang 911, Nathan tried three times to enter the bedroom, but was driven back by thick, choking smoke. Then the smoke detector sounded. Nathan rushed next door and, with his bare hands, tore a hole in the adjoining wall and pulled Travis through. He suffered second and third degree burns to 50% of his body, including his face and head. A few minutes later, firefighters found Bradley in his bed. He died 6 days later. The fire had smoldered for 19 minutes before the ionization alarm activated. Mercer sued one of the world's largest smoke alarm manufacturers. In May 1998, Judge Sean Tyler, in his summation, said, "A smoke detector that sounds approximately 19 minutes after smoke reached its sensing chamber is like an airbag that does not deploy until 19 minutes after a car accident." The Mercers were awarded $16.9 million. The case was appealed. Then, in January 2000, in Ontario, Canada, the Mercer tragedy was made public in Silent Alarms, an award-winning TV documentary that showed ionization alarms being rigged and tested. Their failure rate was approximately 75%. The ionization alarm manufacturer took legal action against the producers of Silent Alarms, preventing it from being screened again. Finally, in February 2001, the Mercer case was settled out of court with a confidentiality order. In February 2003, in the small township of Waihee, New Zealand, fire destroyed the Zonneveld house. Their ionization smoke alarms went off too late. Five died.
From when I woke up, I heard the smoke alarm, jumped up, turned the light on, the bedroom light, the hall light and the spare light, and couldn't see a thing.
Describe the house then at that stage.
Fully lit. Once I was out, there's no way I can. Impossible.
And you knew in your heart, I suppose, that anybody who hadn't got out?
Yeah, couldn't.
In April 2004, in Scotchtown, rural northwest Tasmania, fire razed the Cohen home. Four children died.
Oh, I just yelled out, get out. Get out of the house. House is on fire. And, went outside and everything just went into a bit of a blur. Everything just happened so quick. It just doesn't comprehend to today. I still can't understand.
A voice just said, my house is on fire. And both my daughters sound the same on the phone. And I said, whose house? And she said, Anita. And the phone went dead. We could see the flames above the trees. The house was an inferno as we were coming along the road. And I said to my husband, oh God, you know, and he just was saying, I hope they got the kids out, I hope they got the kids out, I hope they got the kids out. But I think maybe, just seeing how bad it was, we didn't really know. You know, we thought maybe it might have been too late.
Half hour the house was gone. It was from the time I woke up to, it was like three quarters of the house gone. As you see in the pictures, in the paper and that's virtually what was left. As soon as I popped that window out, that was it. Got a bit of air and it was gone.
Over now to a man I've known and worked with for more than 10 years, Adrian Butler. He's a former professional firefighter.
Thanks. The fire service is telling us that almost everyone has got their smoke alarms installed. And that's great, or is it? The fact of the matter is, most people have a perception of fire based on the movies they see in Hollywood. People think they're going to get out of a fire safely. They're going to be rescued by a heroic fireman. And everyone lives happily ever after. What happens in real life is completely different, and you're going to find out about that in this film.
We have lost a great number of children because the type of smoke detector we have in the home has been inadequate. We do not get early warning. And if you do not get early warning, you're going to have deaths. So if you have a fire at night, you can become trapped in the bedroom. And indeed, the parent can get trapped in the master bedroom and be unable to get through the hallway to the children's rooms.
By that time, you know, the whole house was just like a lounge room was just engulfed.
That's when I realised Sean was out, and yelled out to him, I said, I can't get the girls out. You know, I said, I didn't get the girls out. I said, you know, you've got to help me get the girls out. And yeah, by that time, the lounge room, the house was so, smoke was just wafting out of the house, like thick, black, horrible smoke.
And I tried to get down to the kids' rooms, knew it was possible. The other fire anywhere or couldn't hear or see, and I told Sue to get out, so Shane passed me in the hallway when I was trying to get down to the rooms, but I didn't see Shane.
This is the spot where Colin Zonnefeldt's house once stood. On March the 23rd, 2003, members of three generations of Colin's family were killed in a house fire that could have been prevented. Although the house was fitted with smoke alarms, Colin's mother, his partner, his daughter, and his nephew and niece all died in the fire.
So, well, she got Shane out, and then she must have come out straight behind him, but the flames got her from behind, and she was quite burnt and jumped. And then, yeah, we found her outside.
For years now, firefighters have been telling us how important smoke alarms are in warning us about fire. And they're right, of course. But even though most homes are now fitted with smoke alarms, we're not yet seeing a corresponding reduction in house fire deaths. Where about smoke alarms?
Above the stairs and below the stairs.
Now those smoke alarms were, what do they call them?
Ionization.
They're the standard smoke alarms, yes, that we can all buy.
Everyone can, yep.
And you tested them?
Yes, yep. They test them, they work, yep.
My mother was a very light sleeper, Sue was a light sleeper, and if the alarms had gone off sooner, everyone would have got out. But it was too late.
It didn't save the other five lives.
And the smoke detector was like here, the girls' room, the lounge room, our room, and the kitchen. Just went and brought a brand new battery and had in it, but it never notified us. Just didn't, never made a peep.
And the one device they put in the homes is a smoke detector that is largely a piece of junk. It's a defective detector that has an extremely high failure rate.
The Fire Chiefs magazine stated 50 million smoke alarms have been installed in Americans' homes, yet we don't have a corresponding drop. There's no drop in fire deaths. We can't explain this. That was said 15 years ago. These people have been reading these statistics. This stuff's been out for so long. So why do you take it to the people at the top who have a track record of failing to solve it, or do you take it to the mums and dads, the ones who are going to have their kids burnt up? And I can tell you now, before anyone watching this message tonight, most people who watch it on the first take are going to think, no, this can't be true. Kids are going to die, and more people will be dying before the message gets out.
7 hours after that interview in Scotchtown, northwest Tasmania, a Sunday turned into tragedy for three families. Sean and Anita Cohen woke at 11 p.m. to find their house full of thick black smoke. They managed to escape with three of their children, Robert 10, Maggie 11, and Joshua 7. But Joshua raced back inside to save his sister, Claire Polk, 12, and her friends, Taylor Braid, 10, and Danny Wigg, 13. Despite desperate rescue attempts, all four children died.
And then I yelled out to the kids. And then I asked the other two, I said, where's your brother? And I didn't realise he'd gone back in, Josh. It hurts more around birthdays. Joshua's birthday, it would have been 18 May. And Claire would have been 13 in October. Christmas is not going to be Christmas this year. No way.
You know, you just keep thinking about it. It's just, it never goes away. I just can't get rid of it. So I just got to put up with it, you know. So, there's not much more I could say about it. It just, things should never have happened. It never even dawned on me about the smoke alarm at the time, when the fire was there, and it sort of never hit me afterwards either, you see. And Nita done cooking, all the smoke alarm goes off, you see. So I knew it was there, and I was, afterwards, like, and I asked her, I said, well, didn't the smoke alarm go off? And then Nita said to me, she said, no. And I couldn't believe it. How full was the house with smoke when you Sean woke up? He said, well, there's a fair bit of smoke about. At home, I tested my own, so I whacked in, and I thought, well, I'll test it. So I got me fire there, the fire's going. So I opened the door, and of course I had damped down pretty well, so it was pretty smoky, so I held the smoke detector straight above where the smoke was coming out, and the thing still wouldn't go off. And the light wouldn't come on. So then I knew that it wasn't working properly with the fire smoke. The oil off when we burned the toast, when I tested the fire, nothing happened with it. I held it there for a good 10 minutes and it never went off. And the smoke was coming out and you could smell the smoke all through the house and you could see it hanging up in the ceiling for, you know, about that much. And still nothing. So then I knew straight away that these things are not working properly. So they shouldn't be putting them sort of things on the market for to get people believing that these are protecting you and they're going to save your life.
So when someone is in bed at night and a fire starts in the living room or the kitchen or wherever, and that fire is allowed to become large and deadly before an alarm sounds, the chances that you're going to get out of that bedroom and get to the doors and get out of the building are very slim.
You hesitate and that's it. Your chance is blown.
You hesitate, that's it. You're gone. You've got no second chances. You've got to get out in the first minute and a half, 2 minutes at the most. That's maximum. Yeah.
Another thing, I like talking to people, oh, you know, we've got a fire plan, you know, they know to meet at the mailbox, you know, they know to shut the door. I said, but when you're waking out of a deep sleep, that's who, that goes. Fire plans and things just don't come into your brain. It's just, my God, there's a fire, I've got to get the kids out. You panic, kids will panic, as we found out.
When it comes to fire in a home, the small the 5-year-old child and younger, they are being killed at about twice the rate of other age as a whole. The home become more dangerous fire. You have a large open area, the living room, dining room, family room, and these areas are filled with things that start fire.
How many of us leave the television on standby and think that we're safe? But in actual fact, all it's saying is there's no picture on the screen. There's still power going into the back of that television. That is still a possible source of fire. Multi-boxes are superb for putting lots of plugs in. But what we're actually doing is overloading the circuits in the house. They're not actually designed for that number of appliances to run off that particular point or that circuit. And what can happen is that the wires get so hot that the insulation starts to burn. And it burns merrily away, setting fire to everything else around it before the fuse on that circuit finally gives up. Because the fuse breaking relies on the wires touching. Now, if the insulation's burning and the wires still haven't touched, then fairly obviously we've got a fire before the fuse blows. So the fuse doesn't always protect us.
You have furnishings in there that burn very rapidly. We are getting more and more combustibles that burn very, very rapidly. The plastic materials today can burn explosively fast and they can produce extremely toxic gases.
Nowadays, we're heavily into synthetic products. If you just look at the clothes you wear, if you look at the materials you're using around your home, the curtains, the lounge suite, you look in the kitchen, you look at the bench top. Bench tops are often made of a plasticized type material. All of those produce horrible toxic fumes very, very quickly. It's those that can kill you as well as the flames. As soon as a fire occurs, the first thing that happens, of course, is smoldering and smoke. The room fills with smoke. It takes about 2 minutes for the smoke level to come down to your head level. It's full of toxic fumes. It's got hydrogen chloride in there, cyanide, carbon monoxide, all of the most deadly toxins we know of. You have to get out fast. You can't stay in there. You've got to get out of that house in under 2 minutes. To do that, you need early warning.
When we were returning from our filming in Tasmania, We were on board the Spirit of Tasmania ferry and we noticed every compartment on that ship had two types of fire detectors, a photoelectric smoke alarm and a heat-activated sprinkler. Now, whether you're on a ship, in a plane or in a commercial building, if fire breaks out, you must have early warning, and in most cases they have excellent fire detection systems. But most fire deaths happen in residential buildings. So given the high level of fire protection commercially, why have anything less in your home where your family is sleeping? What's amazing is so much of the children's clothing today is highly flammable.
Children playing with matches will ignite bed clothing or draperies or what have you. By the time the mother realizes that there is a fire, it is already too late. She can't get into the bedroom. The child may have hidden under the bed or in the closet. There's no way to rescue him.
So what we're saying is if you do have a fire in a child's bedroom, it's really important today to get the earliest possible warning.
Unless we have complete fire detection in the home with reliable detectors, we are not going to get early warning of fire. We are going to trap people in bedrooms. For example, of a little girl going into her own bedroom during the daytime when the house was occupied and there were a number of people there and the fire occurred in the bedroom and she died and the people did not even know there was a fire in the bedroom until they opened the door and she was already dead. So you cannot count on being aware of a fire in a separate part of the house prior to that fire becoming potentially deadly.
When it comes to detection of fire in a home, we've actually got three different types of detectors. We've got two types of smoke alarms or smoke detectors and a heat detector. Now, the most common type of detector is the ionization smoke detector. The less commonly known detector and the more efficient detector is the photoelectric detector. And in fact, the new Australian standard that was enacted a few months ago requires that every new commercial building here in Australia must have in every sleeping area and in every exit way a photoelectric smoke alarm. Why is that? Because, and the answer to that is simple, they're so efficient.
One of the issues that most people are concerned about is smoke detectors keep going off. And that's often why they've removed the batteries from them. There is an answer, and it's called a heat detector. Rather than put a smoke alarm, whether it's ionization or photoelectric type, near the kitchen, put a heat detector in there. It goes off at a specified temperature, not when there's a lot of smoke around, when there's real heat generated. And then you won't get the false alarms.
Now, we do have a type of smoke detector that will detect fire and detect it rather reliably, and that's called the photoelectric type smoke detector, and that is in very few homes. So I am urging that people get photoelectric type detectors. And I also would like to see heat detectors as part of the detector. And the reason for that is this. There are two types of fire. One is a smoldering fire, and the smoldering fire can go on and produce carbon monoxide slowly and gradually put people under when they're in the bedrooms. And if they do wake up, they're groggy, and that's why sometimes they will get to the front door and not get out. They don't know what they're doing. Very often they're already suffering from carbon monoxide poisoning.
Through the blankets back and sort of up, yeah. So you've gone from sleep to instant wake, and like by that time, like the smoke was at my hip. It was fuzzy. I was there in body, but it was just crazy.
So we have to have a detector that will detect the slow smoldering fire, and that's the photoelectric detector. The fast fire, the flaming fire, will produce heat very rapidly.
I heard an odd noise in the house. I heard it once and it startled me, but I didn't get up. Got out of bed and, you know, still half asleep and staggered out of the bedroom and headed towards this lounge room and sort of seen these flames, you know, I mean, terrifying.
And the best detector for detecting the flaming fire is a heat detector. And those two detectors can actually be combined now in a single detector. Any event, whether they are separate or united, both a heat detector and a photoelectric type smoke detector are essential.
If we take a look at the Waiahee disaster, 5 people lost their lives. 2 were saved. The 2 that were saved were warned by the smoke detector. And the smoke detector was an ionization type. So it went off, warned them, they got out of the house. But still 5 people lost their lives. If we had photoelectric smoke detectors in that particular house, would more lives have been saved? And I think the answer is obvious, yes. If you had been given up to an hour's pre-warning of the possibility of a fire breaking out, then you can get out of the house really quickly and lives will be saved.
There's one issue that really makes my blood boil, and that's when people make statements like 1 or 2 smoke alarms are better than none at all. While this may sound reasonable, this kind of thinking totally lacks integrity and has resulted in thousands of fire deaths worldwide. Let me explain. A family is driving along in a car, mum and dad are in the front, the 3 children are in the back, and a policeman pulls the car over. He notices only 1 person has a seatbelt on. What would you think if the policeman said, "Hey, that's okay, 1 seatbelt is better than none"? That policeman has a duty of care to make sure everyone is properly protected. Now, given that most commercial buildings where people are sleeping have a high level of fire protection in all areas, and that the home has become so much more dangerous from fire, why compromise and put your family's lives at risk by just putting 1 or 2 smoke alarms in your home?
When there is a real fire in a real home, the ionization detector is unlikely to operate prior to the fire getting large enough to trap you in the bedroom.
Later on in the film, you're going to hear from several people who've had ionization alarms. They've had numerous ionization alarms in their home. They've had a fire. The house was filled up with smoke, and not a single smoke alarm has gone off. Yet these are the very same alarms that are protecting most families worldwide who have smoke alarms. They're probably the same alarms that you've got in your home protecting your family right now. How could this be possible?
To answer that question, we spoke to fire protection engineer Richard Patton, who has been campaigning for better fire education and a comprehensive home fire protection system in the United States in his own war against ineffective smoke alarms. He has exposed a trail of corruption from the multi-billion dollar fire safety industry to the current worldwide domination of ionization type smoke alarms. In 1966, Patton was appointed chairman of 4 fire protection committees that had already developed fire detection standards for industrial and commercial premises. There was no code for residential premises, so Patton created National Fire Protection Association Household Fire Warning System No. 74, or NFPA 74, the world's first standard to protect life in homes. NFPA 74 recommended that thermal or heat detectors to be installed in every room. During the next 8 years, manufacturers of the new ionization smoke alarms used NFPA 74 to manipulate the facts in their favor. They recruited firemen to sell the new ionization type smoke alarms, claiming that 75% of all home fires were smoldering fires, and that the ionization alarm was so sensitive it would activate even before smoke was visible. This was done in spite of the fact that laboratory tests had showed that a combination of heat and photoelectric alarms was the most effective way of detecting both smouldering and hot flaming fires that produce large amounts of toxic gases, the type of fires that are most likely to cause death. Heat and photoelectric detectors were deliberately ignored in favor of ionization detectors. Millions of ionization units were sold worldwide, yet the fire death toll did not decrease correspondingly. Thousands of people died in home fires where ionization detectors were installed. From 1974 to 1976, the US government funded a series of tests in the Indiana Dunes Wildlife Preserve, the so-called Dunes tests, to investigate smoke and heat alarms. The average activation time for ionization alarms in a smouldering fire exceeded 1 hour.
So here you've got a condition where if you tell the public that they're not working, there could be legal ramifications for the people who had been promoting them. And if they fail to tell the people, you can have more fire deaths. And guess what they did? They covered it up. They covered it up. And I can tell you, during the entire 76 tests of the Dunes test, in every instance where there was an honest test of a heat detector, the heat detector performed exactly as it was supposed to. But they had falsified the test, they had lied about the results, they had cooked the data to prove that ionization detectors would detect under conditions where they would not detect, and they changed the code to make entire nation available to be sold ionization detectors and only ionization detectors. And the people who were promoting the ionization detectors made billions. And it was all done with smoke and mirrors, with falsifications, with lies, with rigged tests. I realize that it is difficult for people to believe what I am saying, that people could have deliberately falsified fire research when human life was concerned. However, for anyone who disbelieves what I am saying, I prepared an engineering analysis of the Indiana Dunes tests. I documented every lie, every falsification that they wrote into those tests. This is now on the internet. If anyone doubts the validity of what I am saying, you can go in and you can check for yourself, and I will guarantee you that there is nothing I have said about that test program that I cannot personally back up.
Hatton exposed the Dunes tests cover-up and distributed 3,000 smoke detector fraud reports detailing the falsification of ionization alarm performance. And so began Patton's crusade against fire deaths.
Corruption that occurred within the United States in terms of falsifying the performance of heat and smoke detectors, that's been exported. We exported our corruption. We have convinced a good portion of the world that the smoke detector that does not work, the ionization detector, is what's needed. What they have done is fraudulent, dishonest, corrupt, and I also think that what they have done has resulted in at least 50,000 fire deaths and probably 250,000 fire injuries. What they have done most of all is kept protection out of the homes.
You knew your son was Shocked, but all right.
Yeah, he was all right.
And did you know that Sue was dead?
No, well, she was still breathing. She was, yeah, she wasn't conscious, so.
And all this happened how quickly?
Oh, seconds, really.
I can imagine. Yeah.
We've all experienced smoke alarms going off when we burn the toast. But hey, burning toast doesn't burn your house down. There's many cases where people have had fires and their smoke alarms haven't gone off.
Something told me in the back of my head, something told me to go inside. And as I opened the door, it was just full of smoke. I've had three smoke alarms, not one of them were going off. I bolted in, got the kids out of their bedrooms. As it turned out, it was a smouldering fire in the rubber underneath the washing machine. It had been dislodged and was spinning on the rubber, but the house was absolutely full of smoke, burning rubber smoke, but the smoke alarms did not go off.
So we just sort of had some stuff cooking on top of the stove in a frying pan and went outside to the pool area and sort of just forgot that we had it on there. And when we came back inside, the whole house was just full of blue smoke. And no fire alarms went off, which were installed ages ago, and they just didn't go off.
And very often, not only does it not warn when the fire is growing large, it does not warn at all.
I had the fire going in the lounge room, and I went off for a shower at about 7:30 that evening. When I come out approximately 10 minutes later, most of the house was full of smoke. And I mean the kitchen, dining area, lounge room, bedrooms. And I have smoke detectors in each one of these rooms, and not one single smoke detector went off.
Smoke inhalation, to my understanding, is what kills. So, you know, with the children, if I hadn't gone inside and it had stayed just a smouldering fire, they would have been sick, if not, you know, harmed in some way or another. And it's really lost all my faith in smoke alarms.
So I find this disgusting that we can be sold these items and they don't do the job that we're told they do.
The lights flashing, the battery, you know, they were pretty good nick, and the place was just full of smoke. You know, there was no alarm went off at all.
I rang the company and everything that made the smoke alarms, and they said, oh, I'm sorry, but you need a special one for smouldering fires.
The majority of deaths occur in the home at night through a smouldering fire. It begs the question, then, why we're using ionisation smoke detectors, which don't pick up smouldering fires.
So far we've been talking about ionisation smoke alarms. Now most of the houses in the street will have one, maybe two, ionisation alarms installed. So how do you tell what type of alarm you have in your home? If you have a look at the alarm, you'll see it has this radiation symbol somewhere on the alarm. It might be on the inside. You may even have to take it down and have a look on the back of the alarm. If you just bought the alarm, the radiation symbol will probably be on the packet and on the alarm itself.
Now I'm going to tell you about something that's going to make the hair on the back of your neck stand up. This little device here, this little chamber, has a radioactive symbol. This device uses as its primary means creating a current, americium-241. Americium-241 has been declared to be 15 times more dangerous than plutonium. The argument is that americium is not dangerous in the smoke detector, but it can escape with aging, it can escape in a fire. You put it into the garbage pail and some kid gets a hold of it and takes it apart to see what makes it work. Now, I raise this question. Since the detector is very defective, so mostly doesn't report the fire, at least not early, since it contains radioactive material that is very dangerous, why use that type of detector? Of course, we know why it's sold. It's a moneymaker. They can make it cheap. The manufacturing cost of this device is about $1. The whole entire fire regulatory system got behind this thing, falsified tests, put out false information, promoted this device. If you have any doubt at all about the significance of this americium in the detector.
Environmentalists, what are the issues regarding ionization smoke alarms in landfill? Is americium really as safe as we are led to believe?
Now, the last thing we're advocating is for you to take your ionization alarms down and have no protection at all. Later in the film, we'll talk about the alternate to the ionization alarm, but until you've got your new alarms installed, do not take the ionization alarms out.
What I like to do is let the people know that these things are not working. And then if they're going to have these things in their house, they're only going to lose their children or their grandchildren or anybody even staying over overnight or something like that, or visitors. So, you know, we've got to tell the public they've got to turn around and get a proper smoke detector that works.
In 1980, the International Association of Fire Chiefs report concluded the IAFC can take no other course but to recommend the installation of photoelectric detectors. The IAFC makes this recommendation because most home fires start from a smouldering source, and because the photoelectric detectors are sensitive to open flame fires as well as smouldering fires. June 1985, Lawyers Alert magazine announced that the vast majority of smoke detectors that are being sold to the average consumer very often don't work. In November 1986, the National Fire Protection Association's Fire Journal reported that the residential fire death rate increases with over 100 million smoke detectors installed. In March 2003, a New Zealand Fire Service media release stated that 80% of New Zealand homes have smoke alarms in them, but fire deaths are on the increase. In April 2004, a new Australian standard, 1670.1, decreed that photoelectric smoke alarms shall be installed in all sleeping areas. At this time, this standard only applies to new commercial buildings.
Yeah, now that I know about ionisation alarms, and they don't work when there's smoke, so I wouldn't have them in my house at all, nowhere.
They can go off with insects, they can go off with your toast burning, they can go off with your cooking, but they do not go off when there is a smouldering fire.
Well, you might get two or three members of the family that are lucky to survive, but you get one or two that don't. And I don't want my family to be in those sort of statistics down the track.
Don't rely on those smoke alarms. They're just too late. Too late when they go off.
One of the single greatest myths about fire is people think it's never going to happen to them. They think they're never going to have a fire in their own home. So frequently I hear people say, it's never going to happen to me.
You know, you just think, oh, never happened to me. And to be honest, I'd never really thought about it seriously.
And don't have a attitude like it'll never happen to me. Because yes, I had that attitude and it has happened to me.
So many consumers believe that one or two smoke alarms is enough to protect their family from fire. But as we've seen, one or two smoke alarms of any type, is simply not enough. We recommend a combination photoelectric and heat alarm be located in every bedroom, in the hallway, lounge, dining room, family room, and in the laundry. We also recommend a heat alarm for the kitchen and the garage, and an all-purpose fire extinguisher that's conveniently located. Put your fire blanket in the kitchen and make sure your evacuation plan is well rehearsed.
Nobody can afford to ignore fire safety in the home. We've given you the essential information, but if you want more detail, have a look at our website and speak to the person who gave you this video. Do it now.